My name is Laura Escobar, and I am an assistant professor at Washington University in St. Louis. I think I've had times when I've been good at math when I was in school, and times when it's been very difficult. Like, for example, I remember I couldn't learn how to do long division from my teachers. So my dad, who is an engineer, he was great at he just sat down and taught me how to do long division, because otherwise I would have not been able to move forward in mathematics. Like, the teachers were like, we cannot let you move forward until you know how to do long division. So yeah, at times it has been hard. And also I in undergrad, I struggled a lot the first time I had to take abstract algebra and analysis. Like, those courses were much more difficult than what I had been taking before. And well, it's good I didn't judge my mathematical ability on how those courses felt, because I worked hard and then things got better. But yeah, so I wouldn't say math has always been natural to me. Like, at times it has been easier than others, but I've always encountered moments when it's hard. In high school, I fell in love with the idea of becoming a mathematician, but yeah, of course I didn't know what it was. I hadn't done a single proof. I didn't know what a proof was. I hadn't learned any logic. So my idea was very romanticized based on mathematicians I had met. But then in undergrad, I started getting a better idea of what it meant as I advanced in my career. And I would say I decided I wanted to be a mathematician in the latter part of my undergrad. I get a better sense of what a career as a mathematician might mean, because before I really honestly had no idea. And so, yeah, I think it also helped that I started becoming more confident in writing proofs. But the more important thing was taking topics courses. So I took topics courses in combinatorics, which is my research. And I found the math was exciting. I always find it fun to think about mathematical problems, but also I found the math I was learning beautiful. So that really, at that point I decided that becoming a combinatorialist sounds great. I want to keep on studying mathematics. I would say that's when I decided, when I knew I wanted to become a mathematician. I work in combinatorial algebraic geometry and combinatorics. So I can tell you a little bit about combinatorics first. So combinatorics studies the structure of finite sets or finite objects. And for example, you can consider the set of permutations. And one of the first combinatorial theorems almost everyone learns is that the number of permutations permutations of n elements is n factorial. Right, so that's one of the first combinatorial theorems, one proofs in a class. And well, in combinatorics, we are interested in understanding not only how many permutations there are, but what is the structure of this set. So, for example, a natural question is, how can you sort a permutation? So this is a natural question from many points of view. From the point of view of a combinatorialist, it's a very natural and important question. And so my favorite type of math, which is combinatorial algebraic geometry, tells you that, well, if you sometimes are lucky and find yourself in a situation where the combinatorial structure is the shadow of the geometry of a variety, which is a set of zeros of multivariable equations. And so this is the case for permutations. A lot of the combinatorial structure is kind of a shadow of what is happening geometrically. And in particular, their combinatorial structure encodes the geometry of certain varieties called Schubert varieties. And well, I won't go into detail of what they are, but one example of how the combinatorics encodes geometry is that the dimension of a Schubert variety can be computed by looking at how many steps you need to take to sort a permutation. So this is kind of like the geometry that is connected to the combinatorics of a permutation. And so in general, the math that I do creates bridges like this between combinatorics and algebraic geometry. So I would say that the main struggle I encounter now more than before, but this has been common at many stages of my career, is time management. And in particular, like there are many projects I would really like to be involved. So projects regarding mathematics or projects to improve diversity. And it is very hard to do it all. So I find it especially hard to balance professional service that I would like to do with my other responsibilities. And like junior mathematicians often receive this advice that they should just concentrate on establishing themselves mathematically before doing this other service work. But of course, this is like emotionally difficult because you want to see change. You don't want to wait until you're like tenured until you can make a change. So it's very hard to balance. And I'm not sure there is an easy solution. So first, I need to be very honest and say that like this question is hard for me because, well, this has to do with the culture I grew up in. So I'm originally from Colombia, and at least in the my culture, like my family or my peers, we're not really like a very comfortable celebrating our own accomplishments. So this is something I've had to learn how to do because it is important to be supportive and cheer like one's own accomplishments. It's really important. So I'll do my best. I was thinking very hard about what am I proud of. And then, well, I realized I usually am very proud of things that I work really hard to accomplish. So one of them was, for example, getting into a PhD program that I worked really hard. Like out of my undergrad, I didn't feel like I was prepared to go to a master and to a PhD because I had done no research. And so I was like, okay, well, maybe I should do a master's where I do a research thesis. And then that master's was a lot of work. I had to teach and do research and take classes. And I worked really, really hard. And I was really proud when the work paid off and I got accepted to a PhD program, which I wasn't sure I was going to make it. So that was great. And similarly, getting an offer for a tenure track position, that would also felt great because, well, you add all the work I did to get into a PhD program plus all the work I did afterwards. That was great. And I would say that I also like other type of accomplishments that I find rewarding is mentoring. So I haven't done a lot of student mentoring yet, but one of the places that has been very rewarding, one of the opportunities, is the Encuentro Colombiano de Combinatoria that I've helped organize. And I was one of the participants as a student back in the day. And this is a conference that's aimed at students, and the goals are teaching them beautiful combinatorics and help them create a community of Latin American combinatorialists. Of course, from many people can identify as Latin American by our definition. And so this has been happening every other year since 2012. And well, as a student, I really enjoyed the experience. And now as an organizer, I find it extremely rewarding to see how the communities have grown, how these students are like, they see each other every other year, although there's another conference. So they see each other every year and they really support each other, and they're like advancing, becoming mathematicians. And that's extremely rewarding to be part of this initiative. Yeah, I've had a lot of mentors and support throughout my career, but I would maybe want to talk about when I was a student at different stages, like undergrad or graduate school, that I like my most valuable support networks have been peers often, that people like my classmates, people in my that are grad students with me, or people that are undergraduates with me, because they have helped me a lot. So for example, in my undergrad, like math became very difficult, as I mentioned before. But I wasn't the only one struggling, fortunately. So there were people around me that were also like finding this new concept very difficult. So we just formed a study group that, okay, it wasn't just studying. We were really good friends and we would like get together and cook, but also we would like study and like try to see how other people were studying, more successful students, what they did differently from us, and we supported ourselves, like each other, during our undergraduate. And similarly in grad school, I also had a support network of like I had people I could discuss math with, especially during my first years when in the US math PhD programs, the first 2 years, they make you take difficult courses and exams, and there's a lot of pressure. So having people that study with you and support you is extremely important. There has probably been a theme in what I have been talking about, which is that I find my work as a mathematician most rewarding when I have done it as part of a community instead of on my own. So with this in mind, I think it's extremely important to build a community, be it of co-authors, of mentors, of peers. And so, yeah, I think this is really important. And I understand that, like, if you're a member of an underrepresented group, it can be hard to find this community sometimes. So if it's hard in your institution, then I think it's important to attend conferences like the AWM Research Symposium, or Latinx in the Mathematical Sciences. There's also SACNAS, the Conference of African American Researchers in the Math Sciences, and many, many, many more. And I have attended some of these conferences, and they've helped me build my support network. But I also come back energized because I'm surrounded by people that look like me and that are similar to me, even if I don't have that many similar people in my institution. So I think this is an important part of anyone's career, I would say.